My name is Sentee, and I am 31 years old.
You don't know
the things.
You don't know the things that I've come through.
You cannot imagine.
You cannot imagine.
Pain, the trials.
The pain, the trials I've had to endure.
You don't know.
You don't know my story.
In Norfolk, I moved to Hampton at a very young age, maybe about 3 or 4. I was primarily raised by my grandmother, due to the fact that my mom had me when she was 16, but my mom was in my everyday life. My father was incarcerated ever since I was about 18 months old, and that is eventually where he passed away. But I was lucky enough for my mom to have met a man who is my dad. She met him when I was 6, and he is still my dad to this day. So I was lucky enough to know what like a two-parent home was like. I didn't really have to struggle. I didn't really know what to eat. I had seen some things. I've seen my parents go through some things. However, they always made sure we never went without. We were able to, you know, have the luxury things, travel a little bit. We always had our necessities. I was always an honorable student. I was always in gifted programs, but I always just rebelled against that. I still got suspended for stuff like fighting and skipping class and stuff like that for no reason, really, because I wasn't raised that way. And my grandmother will always tell me, like, since, hey, if you keep doing this stuff, you're going to end up in jail, you're going to end up deceased, you're going to end up, you know, this, that, and the third. And I used to always roll my eyes, like, girl, you don't know nothing. She would tell me that, like, 13, 14, 15 years old, when I had first caught, I think I caught my first charge when I was, like, 15 for fighting. Somebody was messing with my sister. And even though I felt it was justified, the way I went about it was, like, super reckless, so she would always come down on me like, listen, you get straight A's in school, you have never missed an honor roll, yet you out here getting suspended and catching charges. Like, that's not for a girl of your caliber. And I just never listened to her. I never listened. I just thought being bad was fun, I guess. So I kept going about my business. When I graduated high school in 2006, I moved away from home and went to college to North Carolina A&T, and I had the time of my life. Like, I wasn't thinking about anybody, what anybody had to say, do. I had no direction as far as instruction, somebody telling me what to do every day. So I lived that up to the fullest, but I was also doing reckless stuff out there, like just wilding out, like from stealing out of stores to everything. Like, and not even for money, but just for myself, because I could. I felt like I could get away with it. And I had never got caught, nothing like that, but I just was doing it. Like, stuff that I was never even raised around or taught or had seen myself. And then, I want to say 2007 or 8, I moved back home to Virginia after the passing of my grandfather. And I was here, but I was, I guess you could say, pissed off with myself. Like, I was just living in limbo. I knew by that time, leaving school and moving back home, that I had messed up. I knew that it was a wrong decision, but in the same sense, I felt like I could do it. I felt like I could prove everybody wrong, my grandmother, my mom, everybody. Like, I'm the oldest of 5 siblings, so I always felt like I had to set an example for my sisters and my brother. So when I moved back home, I got a job, I was making good money, but I was still just living like this. Like, I was in the club 3 or 4 times a week. I was in and out of stores, just hanging with different crowds, being influenced to do things that I had never been brought up to do. Just always trying to find a loophole. And if that was illegal, it didn't matter to me at the time. Like, if it was a loophole, I was going to take it. So I would travel, move around. I had moved to Atlanta with somebody that I, you know, at the time considered a friend. And it turned out it just wasn't that way. So in 2012, myself and the girl that I thought was a friend, had rented a car. And we had paid for it for two weeks. And after the two week arrangement, my friend was supposed to pay for it. And she didn't. Although I thought she didn't. So one day I was driving the car. I was pulled over by the police. I stopped, you know, not thinking anything was up. But the car had been reported stolen by the rental car company. So, of course, I got arrested for grand theft auto way in Atlanta, 10 hours away from home. And then the state of Georgia had charged me for having stolen property across state lines. So me at the time, I still didn't realize how serious it was. I'm like, oh, my record is straight. You know, I'm going to get out. Like, they going to give me a bond. Man, listen, it did not go down like that. I ended up, they didn't give me a bond. And then they ended up saying that Virginia wanted to hold me. So I had to wait to be extradited away from Atlanta. So initially I'm like playing hard, like, no, don't call my mom, don't call nobody, don't tell nobody. And one of my friends, she had reached out to her at the time boyfriend to tell him what was going on, but her boyfriend was cool with my uncle and my dad. So that's how that came about. They found out, they were calling, obviously, away from Virginia, trying to figure out what was going on, how to get me out, how to get me home. And essentially, there was nothing that they could do. And everybody was trying to hide it from my grandmother. And I don't remember if it was my sister or somebody who slipped up and told her. But my grandma was in Atlanta the next day after she found out. By that time, I think I had already been locked up for 2 weeks. But the day after she found out, she drove to Atlanta. She met with a bondsman. She paid the bond for me on the having sold the property across a line charge, but then I still had to wait for Virginia to extradite me, which could take up to 30 days. And Virginia waited the full 30 days. They didn't come and get me until the 30th day. So when I got to Virginia, I was let go of my own recognizances, you know, and I'm like, oh my God, I never want to go through that again, because by this time I had been incarcerated for 2 months. I had been incarcerated for 2 months. So I was like scared, just something I had never been through. But I was telling myself, like, I'm never going to go through this again. This is wild. This is crazy. And then I come home to everybody having all these, like, I mean, completely treacherous rumors as to why I was in jail. And none of it was true. And it all had come from the person who I thought was my friend. So, I left. Obviously, that friendship ended. I didn't really have any ill will. I just kind of was hurt. So I let it go. You know, I wasn't nothing I could do about it but change. You know what I mean? So I changed. And in the midst, I had met someone. Someone that I wasn't initially interested in. It was going to be a brand new situation for me because it was a female. So initially, I'm like, no, you know, I don't get down that way. I'm not into females. You know, I appreciate your compliments, but no, I'm not into it. And eventually, I just subsided. I guess I was at a vulnerable point in my life. I had come out of everything that I had come out of. My charges were dismissed once it was proven that, you know, that wasn't my intention, wasn't my ill will to steal a car. Once I came out on top of that situation, I had got two jobs, one being at the shipyard, one was in retail. I still didn't have any kids, so I was like making really, really, really good money. Still partying, still traveling all the time with all the time that I had. And also being involved with somebody new. So eventually our relationship became something that was official. And it was good while it lasted. It was good. I mean, we had good times until infidelity came about. And when that came about, I think I was more hurt because, you know, as a woman, we've all been cheated on by men. And it hurts, yeah. But this stung different because it was like, I gave you a chance to be the first, you know, the something different. I went against my own will. I went against my pride. I went against, you know, naysayers to try something new with her or for her to do me dirtier than anybody's ever done. And she just hurt me so bad that I guess it became a physical situation. Like, whenever we would get into it, I was so angry, I was so hurt that we would get physical. And I had never been in a physical relationship where, or excuse me, in a relationship where anything was physical with a man or anybody. It's just never happened to me. I've been blessed enough to never have been through any type of domestic violence situation. But with her, it was like my anger got the best of me. So a lot of the times, I was the aggressor. I felt like, you a female, so, you know, you doing me dirty, I'm just gonna treat you like a female in the street. So we would constantly get into physical battles. Cops have been called, we both have been arrested for fighting, both have court charges, both dropped the charges against each other just to get back together, just to do it again. It was a cycle. And I didn't realize it at the time, but it was toxic. And I know now that I was just so hurt because I knew I had done things for her that I had done for nobody. You know, things that I take to the grave, you know, and things that I knew that no one else had ever done for her. So it hurt to be hurt by someone like that. And I realized now, you know, that was the most toxic situation that I was in. But I kept going back. It was like I was addicted to the pain. Like, I was addicted to feeling like I could change this person because I knew everything that I had been through. So I never judged anybody for their actions. I never judged anybody for the things that they may do or how they make people feel because I knew that I had been the type of person to do the same thing. So I kept going back. I kept going back despite everything we was going through. I went back for 3 years and eventually, though, I got to a point where I was like, you know, F this. Like, I'm going to get her back. Like, she cheating on me. She doing all of this. I'm going to get her back. So I had met somebody that I work with. And he was cool. You know, he knew that I was in a situation that I wasn't really happy in, that I was trying to get away from. But he didn't care. He was just like, well, if I got to accept being your friend, then I will. You know what I mean? And it's just that. So him and I would hang out behind her back. He would even go to the extent as picking me up on the opposite side of my apartment building just so, you know, she wouldn't find out. But we would hang out, like, and I liked it. I enjoyed it. I eventually felt myself falling for him, and I knew he had already fallen for me because he had expressed that, but I didn't want to hurt him. I didn't want to hurt him. I knew that I was possibly gonna go back to my situation, and if not, I wasn't fully over it, so I could not just put that pain on him or put that barrier on him, on his shoulders, to make him deal with all the toxic behaviors that I had been subjected to, that I was going through, that all the hurt that I needed to heal from. So I had cut him off. He was pissed. Because he accepted everything. And here I am, like, no, I just can't do it no more. Like, I like you too much. I'm not done with this one situation. So we let it go. And finally, we got to a point in our relationship where she had left me. Like, she felt like she was back where she wanted to be after I had kind of carried her for a while. And she left me and treated me like I was an enemy. And that, to this day, is the biggest heartbreak that I've ever been through. I fell into a depression where I didn't give a about anybody or anything. So, once she left me, I had fell into a deep depression. Like, I couldn't understand why somebody you built up and gave so many chances to would turn around and do you like an enemy. Worse than an enemy, honestly. And my depression was like, so it was like every day. It was getting deeper and deeper. Like, I had got to the point where I was just like, forget work. Like, I stopped going to work. I would just lay down all day and cry and cry and cry and cry because I couldn't understand. I couldn't understand. I would call and like try to force her to talk to me, or you know, just tell me like, why would you do me like that? Like, I could deal with us not being together. It was just all the extra that she would say and would do to other people. It just had me like shocked, you know what I mean? Because to this day, you know, even being over the situation, having gotten through it, there are things that I would never do or tell anybody about her or about our relationship, just out of respect for her, you know what I mean? You don't, at the time when I was with her, all that I did for her, I wanted to do. That's what you're supposed to do. So I would never shoot that down to say, oh, well, she was XYZ, or she didn't have this, or she didn't have that, because all in all, I wanted to do it. I couldn't get that time back. I couldn't get anything back, materialistic, anything. So I was just depressed, you know. I didn't care about anybody, from friends to family to my siblings, my niece. Like, I only have one niece. And she was my first niece. She still is. And I would never forget being at my sister's house in my niece's bedroom. And I took a bunch of pills. And my sister came in like, yo, like, what are you doing? Like, your niece, this is her room. Like, why would you want her? She's 2 years old to come in here and find your lifeless body. And her have to live with it for the rest of her years. And I'm crying now because it's so messed up. Because my sister said that to me. And a piece of me cared, but more of me didn't care. That's how bad I didn't want to be here. I'm like, you know, my nieces too should get over it. That's how I felt at the time. And I didn't realize it then, but I was also like, I guess, crying for attention. Like, I would tell my siblings that I was depressed. I would express it, and I would tell them that I didn't want to be here, that I wanted to commit suicide. But I realized now that was me trying to get help. But I don't think, it's not talked about in the Black community. So I don't think at the time anybody knew how to help me, from my mom, my grandma, my sister. I don't think they knew how to. I don't think they knew how to say, well, let's go talk to somebody, or let's go get you some help. It was just kind of pushed off, you know. And I guess because I kept talking about it, nobody possibly took me serious. But I tried to move and get away from this scenery. So I had moved to North Carolina, to the Raleigh-Durham area. I had a job, I was working, you know, everything was cool, but I was still depressed. I would go to work and randomly still just burst out in tears because I didn't understand how I had got to this point of being so hurt by somebody who had hurt me, you know what I mean? I had met somebody in Carolina who I just like to have fun with. He knew that I was depressed. He knew that I didn't want anything serious. I was never trying to pursue a relationship or anything of that nature. We just had fun. Like, he was a placeholder. He filled a void at the time to keep my mind off of everything else. But whenever I left from whatever we were doing, whether it was bowling, the bar, out to eat, I still would cry. I would cry on the way home, and there was nothing that he could really do about that. And then January of 2015, February, I moved back home because another one of my grandfathers had passed away. And that was a blow. You know, I still hadn't recovered from my own depression, so that was a blow. He passed away on February 20th, 2015, and we buried him. We had his funeral on my birthday, February 28th of 2015. So it was rough. Like, I was taking hit after hit after hit and wanting to point the blame or figure out where I went wrong, where was the wrong turn, and I couldn't figure it out. I couldn't figure it out to save my life, so it was hurting my depression even more. And then I had got to that point. By that time, I had cut off all my friends, all my family members. I mean, every single one. And I am deathly tight with my siblings and my cousins. Like, those are my dogs, those are my best friends, including my best friend too. Like, that's my sister. That's not my best friend, that's my sister. And I cut everybody off. Everybody. I didn't want to talk to nobody. I didn't want to go anywhere. I didn't want to be seen. I didn't want to be heard from. I had deleted all my social media. I didn't want any reminders of just life. because I felt like death. I didn't want any reminders of it. So I want to say April of 2015, by this time I'm so depressed that I have been researching ways to commit suicide. I didn't want, you know, my parents to find me like with my brains blown out or anything like that. So I knew I had to find something that kind of just looked peaceful. I didn't want to hang myself and have them stick with that. It was like I was still caring about them, but I didn't care that they were hurt from me leaving. So in April of 2015, I had finally decided that I didn't want to live anymore. I had waited. I was at my grandmother's house where I was living at the time. My grandmother was going out of town, and I knew that. I had disconnected my phone service, my cell phone service, in addition to, like I said, getting off all social media. My grandma was supposed to go out of town. She left. I went to the garage. I got some antifreeze. I made some tea, hot tea, and I poured antifreeze into my tea, about a cup of it, and I drank it, the whole thing. And I was so sure that I wanted to die that I went and made a second cup of tea, added the antifreeze, and I drank that too. And I went and laid down and just kind of waited for the process to happen. And I started, you know, to feel like my heart was beating out of my chest. And I knew, like, in my mind, I'm like, it's happening. It's happening. Like, I'm finally going to have some type of peace. I'm not going to feel like this anymore. I'm not going to, you know, have all these people out here thinking that I'm just somebody who didn't care. I just wanted relief. I wanted relief. And then I dozed off. And I remember my grandmother, she forgot something. And she came back like 2 hours later. So she's calling for me. And she's like, hey, come do this for me real quick. But she wasn't in the room to see my state. So in my mind, I'm weak. I can barely walk. So I'm like, let me pull this off real quick because she's going to be in and out. She's going to be in and out. And I'll, you know, be able to go back to sleep and let this process continue. So she tells me to do something about her. I get up and I collapsed. And she heard it. So she came and she's like, what's wrong? So I'm still conscious. But I don't really know how I looked because obviously it alarmed her enough to call 911. Because she came, she's like, what's wrong? Like, nothing. I just tripped. And she walked back out of the room. I thought she believed me. And the next thing I know, paramedics are rushing into my bedroom. And they check all of my vitals. And I have never felt like, I put it like this, I knew I was about to die. I knew I was about to die because they started moving fast. Once they checked my vitals, it was like I was out of the house in the ambulance and on the way fast. And I remember them talking to me, trying to ask me basic questions, my name, how old I was, and I wasn't answering. I could hear them and I was awake, but I wasn't answering. And they got me into the emergency department. And from there, it was like, I'm gonna say 3 or 4 nurses working on me. So I knew something was happening. I knew, I'm like, okay. I had researched it enough to know that if you drink enough antifreeze, it crystallizes your organs and you can't reverse that. So I'm like, I'm watching these people and feeling these people poke me and trying to look for a vein to get an IV through, and they couldn't. So I'm like, they trying, and you know, my family might as well just go ahead and say goodbye. And they came and was like, listen, we need to get her to ICU. So from there, I don't remember what happened. I woke up, I want to say, a day later in ICU, not knowing what happened. I'm hooked up to so much. My head was banging. And the first thing in my mind is, how the hell am I still here? Like, what? Why? Why? Like, I'm upset because I have failed and I wasn't trying to. I didn't understand at the time why God didn't let me succeed at this. Like, I just was like, look, you know, I didn't reach out to anybody. I didn't send any alarming, I love you, I'm sorry, text messages, posts, nothing. I did nothing like that. Nothing. Not to even one person, because I wanted to succeed. I didn't want anybody to catch me or find me. You found me when you found me, and that was it. So when I woke up, I was mad, I was angry. And then a doctor walked in, proceeded to tell me, you know, what was going on with me and how I was in ICU and that I would need to be there for probably about a week and that I was pregnant. So now I was like extra mad because I'm like, I don't want to live. I want to kill myself. But I can't kill a baby. Like, I can't do it now. So now I'm pissed because I feel like I was forced to live through my pain and I didn't want to. I had been living it for a year and some change already. I didn't want to be here anymore. I didn't want to. So I was upset. He told me I was pregnant and I cried. Not because I didn't want the baby, but because I knew that this was my saving grace and I wasn't looking for a saving grace. So he told me I was 11 weeks, 5 days pregnant. I had no idea. And now I'm in a bunch of pain because I had did so much to harm myself. Now they can't give me any type of like narcotics or anything because I'm pregnant. So everything that was supposed to make me feel better, I couldn't take. I could take like 800 milligram ibuprofen, some Tylenol, all of these little headaches, but that was it. Because I had drank antifreeze, none of my veins were showing up in my arm. So I had an IV, like a pick, I think you call it a pick IV through your neck. And that was painful. It's HEW6. It hurt so bad, but I was just angry, y'all. I was angry. I didn't want to have to face my demons. I didn't want to have to deal with the pain. I didn't want to have to deal with healing, but I knew I had to. And I want to say, because I was like 12 weeks pregnant when I found out, obviously 2 weeks later when I went to my first prenatal appointment, they were already able to tell me the sex. And I found out it was a boy, which I had always wanted a little boy. And I just cried. I cried with my grandmother. I cried because I knew like he was going to be a reason. So when you hear me say, my son saved my life, now you know why.
Sometimes your friends can't stab you in the back. Sometimes you just break down. When this life tries to wreck you, I protect you.
He saved me. The only reason I dedicated myself to becoming healthy mentally was because of him. I didn't want to bring a son into my sorrow, a child period. I didn't want to bring a child into my sorrow. I didn't want to be a depressed mom. I wanted my son to have the memories that I have playing and with my grandma coming to play with us and my mom and dad setting XYZ up for us or whatever. I wanted my son to have, felt like he had a fun mom and his mom plays with him, his mom loves him. And I couldn't do that depressed. So once I found out it was a boy and knew it was never a question to terminate my pregnancy, at that point I had just became worried, like, what did I do to my body? Am I going to be able to sustain this entire pregnancy? Because I didn't know at the time what type of damage I had done to my body. I didn't know if my organs were failing. I didn't know if they were damaged terminally. I had no idea yet. So I was worried initially. Like, now, you know, I don't want to have to an innocent baby die because of my selfish ways. So it became something where I was praying for not only his health but my own. And then focusing on just being healthy mentally. And still, even still, knowing that I was depressed and knowing that I had tried to commit suicide, I still didn't reach out for like your therapy help, your psychiatrist help. I didn't do it. I just was like, I can do this on my own. I'm determined, you know. It was, I guess I still probably felt like it would be something that was frowned upon at the time. So I just embraced my pregnancy. I wouldn't watch anything on TV except for comedy stuff. It sounds so goofy now, but it worked for me. I would watch all the classic sitcoms, Martin, Bernie Mac show, stuff that I knew would make me laugh. Anything sad, anything demeaning, I wouldn't watch it. I wouldn't watch it because I felt like it would trigger all of my emotions that I was experiencing being depressed. And I did that my entire pregnancy. I ended up coming out of my suicide attempt healthy. All of my organs were fine. I had a healthy pregnancy. Besides morning sickness the entire time, I had a healthy pregnancy. And my son was growing. He was growing. He was huge the entire time. By the time he was born, on October 19, 2015, he was a week late and he was 9 pounds, but he was healthy. He had 10 fingers, 10 toes, no issues with his organs. So I was happy. I was happy. It was a new sense of happiness. It kind of brought everyone back into my life, from my siblings to my cousins, my best friend. It just brought everybody back full circle. I was willing at that point to coexist with everybody. I wanted my son to know more than just me. So it helped too once he got here. It was like another boost of encouragement to be healthy mentally. So I kept it up. And then I'm gonna say around the time my son was like 6 or 7 months, I went out for the first time in like 2 years. I had fun. It was like I was getting back to myself. I wanted to get my hair done again, my nails done again, things that I had given up for the past 2 years because I didn't care. Things that didn't matter to me for 2 years, they were mattering now. So I knew I was getting better. And then I would, you know, get dressed, or let's say go something and I have my cousins or my friends like, there she go, she back now, you know what I mean? Like, they were noticing too. So I knew that I was like, hey, okay, you know what I mean? That I had come out of it. So I was over all of my emotions. I was no longer crying at the thought of my ex. I was no longer crying at the thought of my pain. I was no longer dwelling on it. I was healing. I was learning myself. I was learning to love who I had become. I was learning to love my story. I was learning to love honesty, truth, facing my issues, my demons, anything. I was learning to just be me, be a woman, be a better woman. I was learning to be a mom, the best mom I can be. I was learning and I was loving it. I was enjoying it. Every day was something new. And I think we take for granted the change. We take for granted change. Sometimes we get set in our ways and think that there is no room for improvement when there always is. And I have become a completely different person. Not a completely different person. The things that I favored before were no longer interesting. The things that I thought I would never be interested in were now very interesting. So I was happy. I was just learning to be who I wanted to be, who I strive to be. I was also learning to be the type of woman for the type of man that I wanted to attract. So I was just embracing it all, embracing, just taking criticism, you know, not really caring what anybody had to say, and just doing things on my path, on my own time, not competing or any of that, or just comparing anybody else's route to mine. I was okay with the route that had become my story. And my son, let me see, right before he turned one, I told y'all about a guy that I had met during the time that I had met, I was still dealing with my ex that I had cut off, who was like just willing to meet me on the other side of the building to pick me up, to hang out, you know, do everything. We hadn't talked for about 4 or 5 years. That had ended 2012, 2013, and here we are now in 2016, And he found me on Facebook and sent me a friend request. You know, I accepted it or whatever. Like I said, I hadn't talked to him prior to then. And he inboxed me like, oh, you have a son now. You know, he's beautiful. Like, I'm glad to be, I'm trying to reconnect with you. You know, if you're single, you know, send me your number. So I'm like, yeah, I'm single now. So send him my number. We caught up. We proceeded to just catch up with everything that each other have been through over the past 4 or 5 years, and we're engaged now. So we have a beautiful daughter together, and then inclusive to my son, he stepped in and is the man of my dreams. He is everything that I've prayed for. He's everything that I prepared myself to be loved by. He's everything. Like, he, initially I used to feel like my son was going to miss out on having a father figure every day, because like I said, my son's father, I never, you know, had anything with. He was just a placeholder, and he's not involved, you know, with my son at all. So I did a year, you know, parenting him by myself with no ill will to his father, because you take those things and you move on. I would never, you know, argue or try to make a man do what he doesn't want to do. I have been there. I have been there with the toxicity in my last relationship. So I already knew that there was nothing you could make someone do that they didn't want to do. And I was okay with that. I never harped over it. I never argued, fussed, you know, was in and out of court, none of that, with my son's father. And lo and behold, here's Cedric. Just everything. Like, you can't tell him he didn't carry my son. You can't tell him that's not his son. So I love him with everything in me.
From the first day that I met you, you were special. There was something different about you. Had to pray for it before I jumped into it head first. Ain't an expert, but I know I never ever felt like this. Never ever been held like this. Never met nobody real like this. Oh, I should have known when you took my son as your own. I'm not saying I ain't like all the carrots and the stone. It's just your love that I want. Now it's me and you against the entire world. The entire world. I see our love when I look at our baby girl. I'm a lucky girl. Oh, you're the greatest love I ever seen.
He is. I'm just able to, everything that I'm exposing to you guys about my story. He's already knew. He's knew everything. The things I hadn't told my family members. I'm pretty sure there are plenty of people who thought they knew what I've been through and don't, who didn't know at all that I attempted to commit suicide, who sent well wishes via my family members and never knew why. But these are all things that I was able to sit down and have a conversation with my significant other without him ever having to hear it from anybody else. And before we were engaged, I knew he was the one for that alone. I never have been scared to share my skeletons with him. I've never been scared to feel like he's going to treat me any differently because he knows my story. And he hasn't. He's loved me through it all. He knows it all. There's nothing that anybody can tell him about me that he doesn't already know. From the good, the bad, the ugly, the indifferent, he knows. And I think that is a piece of the beauty in our love, because I can sincerely say he loves me flaws and all. And the same for him. There's nothing that he could or has ever told me that would make me love him any less. He's completed me. He's completed my family, from just the support and love from his family members as well as my own. Creating my daughter, you know what I mean? Like, he is the reason, another reason why I'm blooming. He's another reason why I am where I am. I am who I am. He supports it all. He supports it all. He gets me together behind closed doors too. And it's so ironic that he was someone that I kind of, he gonna tell you I played him to the left, but I didn't. I just knew he was a better man than somebody that deserved to have only a piece of me years ago. I knew that he was somebody that deserved the full me, and I couldn't give that to him years ago. And now that I can, or I have, I couldn't be happier. he contributed to me just feeling like that there was beauty in my struggle. Like my story, everything that I went through was so worth it because, and it took, honestly, it took for somebody that I've known for years, that I went to school with, to randomly write me on social media and say, Sentee, your family is so beautiful that I can only imagine everything that you've been through to get here. And her message, she don't even know, it made me cry. Because I don't think a lot of people know. A lot of people don't know what I've been through, how I grew to get to where I am. I would have never been able to be the mother that I am. I would never be able to be the woman that I am to my fiance if I hadn't been through what I did. I don't know how else to put it into perspective other than to tell everybody there is beauty in the struggle. You don't see it now, you won't see it now. But if you put your concentration behind being better, being a better person, that the beauty will come. You will enter your blooming season. Everybody always asks me, like, girl, what's the prayer? You had the Sierra prayer. And I tell people all the time, there is not a prayer for the man. The prayer was for myself. The prayer was for me to be better, for me to be more of an honest woman, for me to have a better relationship with God, for me to be a better mother, for me to be the woman of what type of man I wanted to attract, for me to be open to change, for me to be unselfish. That was the prayer. That was all I was praying about. I was never praying about a man. In fact, I was content with just me being, it being me and my son for the rest of my life. Cedric was like a bonus, a hell of a bonus. He was a bonus, but I'm glad that I had him. I don't know, or in fact, I don't want to know life without him or my children. I want them by my side at all times. And I'm looking forward to going into this new chapter of being a wife, being a mom. We have a couple things in store in regards to what we're going to, I can't tell y'all, but we have some things in store for just our families, to make things better for us, to make things better for our family. But we have some things in store, and I look forward to sharing it with you guys. I look forward to hopefully getting some support from everybody. But believe me when I tell you, I've never, ever, ever been as happy as I am now. And I'm happy to be sharing my story, hoping for the rest of you, and to encourage the rest of you to look forward to your blooming season.
By the way it feels, and if I am a reflection of him, then I must be fly. Because he is, yes he is. I wonder, does he know?